All right, we are now in record mode, and so we're going to attempt to record both the audio and the video portion of the webinar. So welcome to your May 14th EGS webinar. All right, guys, if you have any problems hearing me, you know, send me a message. If I get too fast, send me a message over the message box. I can't promise I will see them all. We do have about 100 users, it looks like, on the webinar today, which is fantastic, but it does certainly limit the ability to speak with everybody. But here we go. First things first, let's look over here at the left navigation menu. For those of you that have not ever logged in, you will definitely need to contact support, all right, to get a user ID and password, or go to your administrator for a user ID and password. And over here on the left navigation menu, there is a link called Important Links. I want to start here today, because this is critical. What you want to do is go down here and you can go to APWU EGS support, which will go over to the APWEGS.com website, which is, by the way, the central site for the system, at which point you can fill out a support request, putting in your name, local, email, and phone, and submitting that to us so that we can help you out. That is the very, very key feature for getting help on EGS. And also over here on the Important Links menu, we have things like video tutorials. We've got EGS user guide for those of you that are new users or new presidents, new local union administrators of the system. I certainly encourage you to visit this user guide. It will help you get started. That's a very, very important thing to look at. And this Important Links function is very nice. Now, the second part of doing that, after you've explored the important links, especially the user guide, you want to go and I want you to add a grievance, all right? I just want you to go in and create a grievance, even if it's a dummy grievance, a generic grievance, whatever. I want you to just go in here on the left navigation menu, over here on the left, and click Add, all right? Once you click the Add link, the next step will be to select the member from a drop-down list. Your system, if it's brand new, you won't have anybody in this drop-down list. It's just going to be blank, so you'll do new member, all right? But for today's purposes, let's select Abe Abernathy, and let's say he works for employer USPS, and we click on Next. So it's not a complicated process. Just try to make it as simple as possible. Go through here. Now, if we've had a grievance for Abe before, then all of his information, all the way down to PREF eligible, will be completed if that was completed the first time around. So it's very nice. You don't have to recreate this. After you create a grievance for an individual the first time around, the system will automatically remember that person. So that's very, very good stuff. All right, let's do a grievance 2014. It's month 05, 987654. All right, that's just the generic grievance number. Your local can come up with your own unique numbering technique. Do not put too much time into the numbering because their system is so robust, the search features alone, you just don't need as much data in numbering anymore. But it is you can do whatever you want at the local union level. All right, May 14th is the date of grievance filing. And as you can see down here, you've got everything from nature of issue. So this, let's say this is an overtime case. We're looking at the contract. This is your CBA. Let's just say maybe this is a CBA Articles 8 Hours of Work, something to do with the Article 8 Hours of Work case. So you can put one contract here. I'll show you in just a minute, though, how you can actually attach multiple articles to the grievance itself. So you're not limited to one, all right? This is just an area in which you're recording the initial input, your step one, if you will. The unit information, second branch state office, step one meeting. So if that's, you know, if the step one meeting may be on the 20th, then we can put in that date. You could put in the USPS supervisor information. And, of course, if you're the steward entering the case, let's say that I am John Smith. I will record myself as John Smith. And that will, you know, be nice because all of the stewards for each local will be listed here. That way the steward that created his or her case can go in and continue working on it. Step one decision, name and title. Step one decision date, all right, and then you've got the initials that verify the date of the decision. Now, as I scroll down, all right, here we've got the background. So the background info goes here. That could be several paragraphs. It could be You know, it may just be a one sentence, but this will be where the background of the case information goes. What we encourage you to do, if you have a whole lot of information, the system does time out after 45 minutes, so don't leave it stagnant, just sitting around. If you haven't saved in a while, always go up and just click save. Make that a good habit with whatever technology you're using, clicking on save. Corrective action, all right. Corrective action goes here. All right, and down here you can put the management response. It says dot, dot, dot. That's where the management response is. And so you've got your background, your corrective action, management response, and this is where you're recording the initial grievance input. All right, that's what I challenge you to do first. If you're a newbie, go in there and record a step one. Just put in the information. Don't worry about anything yet, and then click on save. All right, this is critical. Once you click save, I want you to notice something. You click on save, and all of a sudden you've got this PDF button. All right, the view PDF comes up, so you can actually click on view PDF, and this is going to look and feel like your current grievance form, as you well know it. Okay, so this is your PDF document. It generates the PDF for you guys, so you don't have to go in and recreate the PDF. So everything's done for you on this uniquely designed system. And the cool thing about it is you just need to plug in the numbers and you need to plug in the data and hit save. And every time you hit save, it will automatically update your PDF buttons. So once you save a grievance, what I would like for you to do, you'll notice on the left navigation menu, after you click on save, it puts the grievance number at the bottom left, so you always have access to know which grievance number you're working with. And you have all of these options. You can go into your Step 2 appeal. So if I click on Step 2 appeal, well, the information from the Step 1 will be automatically brought over to the Step 2 appeal form, the relevant information. So even if you feel like you need to go straight to a Step 2 appeal form, you will need to ideally create some information on the Step 1 anyway just to transfer it over to your Step 2. Okay, so that's it's almost like your key that you're creating in the grievance file itself. So that's all fine, all right? Once you are in the Step 2 appeal, though, you've got the authorized union rep. I'm just going to use Balogun here. I know he won't mind. You've got the area code, office phone. You've got email address you can record. And as you can see down through here, there's several different data criteria you can record, including USPS Step 2 designee, installation, phone number, USPS grievance number, as that's sometimes given a separate grievance number than what you have on your system. And then, of course, down at the bottom, the background information was brought over, as was your corrective action plan. And then, of course, you could put your signature, title, and date down here at the bottom. Let me show you what happens. Once we click on save on your Step 2 appeal form, it generates the view PDF again. So now you've got your Step 2 appeal form PDF as well as your initial grievance Step 1 PDF. And how do you know what documents you've got in the system? As you're going through your Step 2 appeal, and then, of course, if it's a direct appeal to arbitration or a Step 3 appeal, you'll go fill out that form. So on the Step 3 appeal, we can go into that form and continue filling out the Step 3 appeal if it is a Step 3 appeal in this case, and it will save that PDF. You can view PDF there, and as you can see, this is your Step 3 appeal form. So here's what's happening, guys. You're going through, you're creating a Step 1. Once you save that, it creates the initial case file, which is your grievance number. This grievance number is a file on your system, okay? It's a virtual file. It's just like if you took a file, folder, all right, and you put it into a filing cabinet. This is what happens. You take this filing folder, you put it into a filing cabinet, and this is the number that you created, all right? So once you've created that number, you will be able to go over here and you will actually be able to put all the documents you want into that particular file. Okay, so here's how it works. Let's rehearse this again, all right? I'm going to slow down so everybody can kind of catch up with me, all right? I think we've got everybody on that needs to be on. You go through the process. You enter the grievance by clicking on Add, all right? Once you add the grievance, you click on Next. Of course, you go through the grievance process. You enter the number, the date, the grievance information, and you click on save. Let's go into the grievance we were working with just a second ago. Give me just a second to pull it up here, guys. I backed out of it, so let me allow you all to catch up with me so I can pull this up. All right, so we've got, this is the grievance we were working with, Abe Abernathy's case. We've gone through the step one. We've gone through step two appeal. We've created the step two appeal worksheet, the view PDF, gone through the step three appeal. All right, and now you want to see the documents. All of the documents you've created, your step one, step two, step three, are all right here. But what if you need to upload some outside documents? Well, you do it in the same exact area. So you choose the file, and let's say you've got a grievance statement of facts or something like that. You open that, and you upload that document. All right? So this can actually allow you to upload PDF, Word, Excel, JPEG, GIF, TIFF images, really any major file type that you have, you can upload the document. And that's so handy because once you upload those documents and once you go through all of this process of filing the step one, two, three, information requests, extension requests, corrections and additions, you will need to email those moving papers out, all right? So in order to email the moving papers, you've got this email moving papers category over here on the left navigation menu. You can click email moving papers, and you can say, all right, I want to send these moving papers right now. So on 5/14/2014, I'm going to send all, or you can select individually. If you have a whole lot of documents, keep this in mind. This is something we run into on a, you know, not too often, but sometimes it comes up in support. If you have a whole lot of documents, break them up into pieces. What I mean by that, let's say you have 20 or 30 documents listed here. Maybe send out three emails with 10 documents each, or three emails with, or four or five emails with a few documents each. The reason is because some inboxes just simply won't receive large amounts of files at once and a large data set. So, you don't want to oversend something and not know if it got there or not is a basic premise behind it. But let's say we got Justin's the sender. And you could type in the email address, or you could select from the notification list, which is your email contact list, to whom you want it to send. And you can build up your notification list over here in the contact list area, by the way, which is very nice. All of you should definitely do that. So the message is testing EGS. So once that's done, at the top we've got a send button. All right, so all of your documents are selected, and we can send. And it comes back and it confirms email sent. And so it will automatically send this email within a matter of minutes to whomever you set it to send. So it's going to send all of the documents and everything. And it comes right back to this screen so you can continue sending more. So if you are breaking apart your emails and breaking apart your documents, that's a good thing. And it will come straight back to this screen so you can continue with your next section of documents that you need to send out. All right, guys. Now, one thing that I do want to note is that you've gone through and you've gone through and you've created your step one worksheet, your step two appeal, your step three. You've sent out and uploaded some documents. Perhaps you're just on like your tablet or your iPad or your phone, and you just want to see a summary of the grievance. Well, there's a link over on the left called Grievance Summary. All right. And what that's going to show you, it's really just going to show you links to the documents, which you can click on and view the documents, and it's going to show you the information of the member and where the status is currently at. The case status is at step three appeal. Okay, so that's where you'll be able to see what's going on just quickly. You know, that's very handy if you're on your phone or something like that. With all that said, though, I don't want to divulge too much into all of these details over here because we've got a few more things I do like to cover. But for all intents and purposes, we have so many new people on the line today. What I want to show you that the next level is how to search a grievance once you've entered it. So I guess the challenge for all you new folks out there is to go in and create that first grievance. and be able to go over to the search criteria over here on the left and click on search. Once you click search, and you can search by any of this criteria in the middle of the screen. So really, you're concerning yourself today with two buttons, adding and searching. The second being search. And when you go over here to the search, you could search by, let's say, Stewart. All right. We know that we created the last grievance as a John Smith case. Well, heck, if I'm John Smith and I'm logging in, then I could say, hey, I'm John Smith, and I want to see all of my cases, and I could hit find. And sure enough, at the bottom, it brings up all of my grievances as me, the steward. So I can actually click on the one I created today, the 987654, and continue working on it. So that's how you open a case. It's really not hard at all. So let's rehearse that real quickly. If you go to grievance search on the left navigation menu, you could even search by things like employer, date filed. Let's say you want to see a whole date range, you know, of grievances that were filed maybe all of this year. Let's go back to January 1st through tomorrow, okay? So let's see everything that was filed on the system this year, and we could run that, and sure enough, we've got in the sandbox system a few grievances out there. And you could even export this over to Excel. It's a very, very nice. Once you run the report, it shows you the grievance number, the employee name, the articles associated with the case, the date filed, the status of the case, whether it's a step one, step two appeal, step three. Of course, the employee identification number, the craft, and things like that. So it's not complicated, but that export to Excel is very nice for printing and anything like that. So it will export the whole report over to an Excel spreadsheet, as you can see right here. It's a little bit small, so let me beef that up for you guys. All right, so you can use Excel for the great tool that it is, and you can you can of course data sort the report or anything like that. If you have any questions though about using Excel with this system, please email us at support, because we're happy to help with things like that. Once you find the grievance you're looking for, though, let's open it back up. So if we open the grievance right back up, and we can continue working on the case by going and adding more documents, putting in notes on the case or anything like that. And earlier I told you you can add additional articles to the grievance. To add articles, you click on articles on the left navigation menu, and you will actually be able to select any article from a drop-down menu. So if this is it's maybe a holidays, has something to do with holidays, you can add that particular article by simply selecting from the drop-down menu and selecting the article you want to add and clicking Add Article. So it's not complicated at all. The only thing you have to do is make sure you open the case first, and then you'll have that articles link on the left. So really what you want to do, you want to go over to your virtual filing cabinet, pull open the filing cabinet, open the case, which is 2014-05-987654, and then within that folder you've got all of these options. So it's a very clean way of doing it without having to mess with the paper of it all, and driving back and forth or going over to your office or whatever you usually do for those of you that are new to this system. Now, those of you that have been around the system for a while know how all this works, and so you've got several different ideas and options that are coming through, suggestions and support, and all of them have been fantastic over the past couple of years, and we can't thank you enough for those. But what the main purpose of this is to introduce some of the new folks to it and also give you a decent look at some of the new functions, like the timeline. For those of you that aren't familiar with timeline, this is a question that came up from the last session, and so I wanted to address those of you that are familiar with the system but have not really used this timeline feature. Now, this is a nice tool, because what you can do is click on timeline on the left navigation menu and click Add Timeline. And let's say you just simply want to make notes of every day, a kind of a chronological event organizer of what happened throughout this grievance procedure. So you may say that the grievant filed initial case with Steward John Smith. And that may have happened, heck, that may have happened all the way back April 16th, all right? And then so that would create a chronological event start date for April 16th. It doesn't send out any emails. It's almost like a virtual post-it note feature. It allows you to keep up with important dates of events that happened in this case on a chronological day-by-day timeline, all right? So that's why we call it timeline, because it allows you to keep up with the timeline of events that are happening throughout the process. So you can go and add as many of these chronological dates as you want. So that's a feature that many of you may have not explored yet, and it's a very, very handy feature, especially with regards to keeping up with the necessary dates and things like that. Another feature that's a little less robust, if you will, is something called notes, and this is an area in which you can just make simple notes and click on save. It has no bearing on any of the forms that are emailed out. It doesn't even show up on the print summary page. It's just for your eyes only in terms of you making notes on the case itself. So it doesn't show up anywhere outside of this white chalkboard. This white virtual chalkboard is where it shows up, and this is where you will be able to go in and view the notes on the case, if you so choose to make notes, or if another user makes notes on the case with you, if you have two or three maybe stewards or reps working on a case, or the administrator may go in and make a note about the case. Now, all this comes together in a couple of ways, guys, and it's all in reporting. The first set of reports is the search criteria, all right? Give me about three more minutes, and then we'll go to Q&A. The first set of reports is the search criteria, which we've gone through, okay? The second and really one of the most important reporting tools is in the reports menu. Down here on the left navigation menu, we've got something called emails and email moving papers documents viewed. First off is emails. What this report does, it shows you the exact date and timestamp that every email was sent from the system. Now, what it shows you is the grievance number right, at the top. Let's look down here at the bottom. We'll show the most recent. So, yeah, down here at the bottom, we've got this. We've got the grievance number, which is the one we sent out today, and the fact that it was sent, to whom it was sent, that's the email addresses that it was sent to. And, of course, this is the union. This will be your local union number, all right? Right now we're doing a pilot local, of course, but that will say your local. And then over here is the date and timestamp that it went out. So it was sent out at 5:14 at 2:29. That's Eastern time. So that shows you the exact date and timestamp that it went and it was sent out of the system, from the system, rather. So that gives you a confirmation that the EGS did send it. Now, if documents are too large and you're getting feedback from users saying, hey, we didn't receive that, we never got it, then there's a couple of things. We need to go look at the document size to make sure that the documents weren't too large. And of course, sometimes there's something called blacklisting on emails, and it's not fun, but it's just what email providers do. Sometimes they see an email coming from a weird address that they don't know, and they block it, you know. So we'll need to make sure if you're having that issue that we can contact your email provider so that they know that not to block support@grievancetrack.com. You may want to write down that address. It is support@grievancetrack.com. That's the email address that is a good address. The other report I wanted to show you is a rather new report as well. For some of you that have been on the system for a while, you may not have seen this report yet, but it's called Email Moving Papers Documents Viewed. It's a very simple report, but it's nice because now when we send out the moving papers, we not only send the documents themselves, but we also send a link so that the recipient can click the link and view the document in a browser format. And this report shows you every user I'm sorry, every email recipient that clicked on the document and viewed it. So, for example, we've got Roger Barnes here, which is one of my programmers. You can see that he clicked on grievance ID 000. It gives you the date filed of the grievance, and it shows you what document that he clicked on to view. And it showed you that Roger also viewed the document on 1/19/2014 at 6:06 p.m. So it will give you a rundown of every document that's been viewed on your system, all right? And you can, of course, export this report over to PDF, Excel, or Word, all right? It's a very nice report, very clean, and exporting it especially over to Excel will allow you to data sort the different documents and data sort the users and which users clicked which documents, the dates filed. So Excel, using it, again, for the great tool that it is, will allow you to best see the documents viewed and that report. So those two reports are very important, and they're very, very nice to have at your disposal in terms of keeping up with your deadlines and things like that and making sure verification is there for that very purpose. Now, what I've done, guys, I've gone through the add and search function. Most of these maintenance functions I do not want to cover with all of you because a lot of you don't even need administrative privileges, so you don't have to worry about it. We don't want to have to have you worry about something you don't need access to, with the exception of contact list. And this will be the final thing that I go over, but it is a very important one because it really does allow you to set up email notifications easier. Since email notifications and moving papers are such a big part of your grievance life, it's important to go in and create a very clean contact list within your system. And by doing this, all you have to do is go to contact list. Let's say I want to add contact list. And let's say I'm Balogun, okay, and I'm a steward user. I'm going to use him as an example. I know he won't mind. But I want to set up my name as a contact list so that I don't have to retype my email every time I go in to move papers. So what I'm going to do, I'm just going to call it Balogun, Itawu Balogun, and then add email address. All right. And then I hit save. All right. So what I did, I actually created a new contact list called Itawu Balogun, and I think I'm saying your name right. I'm sorry if I'm not, Brother Balogun. You know, I'm from Tennessee, so there you go. But anyway, you've got now the ability. He can go in, and when he finds his grievance, so he goes over to search a grievance, and he finds his active cases, and he knows it's employer USPS, and he knows that John Smith was the steward on the case, and he hits find, and it brings up the grievance case file, which he knows he's looking for. And then when he goes over on the left to email moving papers, instead of having to type in his address right here in the to field, check this out. Now we've got I Balogun right there. So he can actually just select his name each time. And all he did was build it in the contact list, and then it transposed it over to this drop-down list so that you don't have to retype every time. And what it does limit the risk of spelling errors and things like that. So with that said, what I'm going to do now, I am going to go to the Q&A session, and we have several coming in, okay? All right, so what we're going to do is look through these, all right, and if you have a question, certainly address them, all right here. This is the time to do it, and we want to get as many as we can within the recording time frame that we have. And I want to start with the first one, and it says, have Mr. Balogun discuss issues concerning local management not wanting locals using EGS. Okay, I'm sure that Balogun was happy to discuss any issues with that. Unfortunately, he is not on the organizer profile, so we can't really turn the audio over to him at this point. We may try to do that here in just a moment, but he would be best suited for that discussion. Secondly, we've got, the system won't allow us to turn a grievance over to a different steward after info is saved. Right. If the steward created the grievance, then he or she will be the one to continue working on it. And if they're not, if you need to transpose it over, that the administrator can take it over from that point and move it around. So we will, you know, send us a support question if you have something specific, but it is locked to allow the steward that created it continue editing it. But there may be a support issue there that we can work with you on to allow the user to be transposed to another steward within your local. And that's something we could do in the profile section of the users. Hello, I'm Carlos Renteria from San Bernardino. Hey, Carlos. Shop steward, I'm having problems sending emails. The recipients are receiving their copies. However, I do not get mine. What am I doing wrong? All right, Carlos, a couple of things which I addressed a little bit ago. You may probably not doing anything wrong. It depends on who your email carrier is. It could be something as simple as the fact that they have blocked the email address support@grievancetrack.com. So they may have blocked that, or perhaps they have your email may be too small to receive large file inboxes. So what I would do, Carlos, is this. I would set up a Gmail account for yourself to carbon copy yourself on every email that goes out. So set up a Gmail account. It's free. And then go into the contact list over here on the left navigation menu and put in that unique Gmail account as your carbon copy. And that way, every time you send out moving papers, you're carbon copying your Gmail account within those emails that are sent. And again, I don't know which email provider you're working with, but it sounds like they are blocking or blacklisting the email. And you can always contact the email service provider and ask them as well. All right. In the date block, are we recording the date of the violation or the date grievance was submitted to the system? Okay, there's several date blocks there, so what I'd like for you to do in that question is send it to support on what specific date block you might be talking about, as there are several dates, and each local may do something a little bit different, too. So send us something over to support, and if it's something we can't answer at support, we'll send it over to the e-appeal team in D.C., which I know Balogun and Mr. McKinnon are forming a new e-appeal team, which is going to be awesome. The team is looking good. So definitely send that question to support, letting us know which date you're specifically referring to. Can the email report be changed to have the most recent on top? You know, that would be a suggestion. So what I would do there, that's something that to enhance the system. It's just a little change we could put in to reverse the role there for the top and bottoms. It certainly can be done. To answer your question, yes, it certainly can be done. And we'll send, if you don't care, send this very suggestion to the email suggestion tool, and we'll send it over to the e-appeal team, and because they're going to be reviewing all the new suggestions coming up moving forward. All right. We had somebody that has some trouble with audio. We do apologize for that. It is a call-in number which you can use. And let me see here. Default calendar on some pages is dated 1969. Can this be updated? If you don't care for that person, we haven't seen that or heard of that yet. If you don't care to send us over to support what pages those are, So fill out a support request form and let us know what pages those are and what browser you're using. And we'll go in and test it on the browser and the support form to see what's going on. Sometimes it's a computer setting, sometimes it's a browser setting. So, that can definitely be fixed, and that's something that we will fix. We just need to know where it's at for the default calendaring. Carlos should carbon copy himself. There you go, Carlos. You always want to carbon copy yourself. Okay, Tan Morris from Dallas, there have been times the system won't allow us to save new data. Okay, message saying that saying the data cannot be saved. All right, that could be multiple issues, Tan. What you'll need to do when that happens is, again, fill out a support form and send the support with the error message that you're getting over to the system support at apwegs.com. The only way we can answer that is if we see the error that you're getting and that way we can go in and try to recreate the issue so that we can properly give you a answer. So what we've got now, I've got Balogun on the line. Balogun, are you on the line with me right now? Let me see if he's – okay. I'm going to turn it over to you guys and then let you guys go ahead and wrap up because this is all the questions we have on the Q&A portion of the system.
Okay. Again, thank you, Brother Justin. You continue to do a fine job for us, and we're happy with the product thus far. Tony also just stepped out of the room. He received a call from the president's office. I'm waiting for him. But while I'm waiting for that, Carlos, I had a meeting with you yesterday on something else, so I have a direct number to talk with you. And a viewer number 86 also mentioned to Carlos, which we enjoy, like a user helping user, that all he had to do was CC himself. But what I also thought is maybe this gentleman was using notification instead of email moving paper. Again, Carlos, you have my email address. Send me email or call me after this. I will walk you through that. Another thing that we're working on is on step two. If you can show us the screen for step two form, Justin?
Yes, I'm bringing it up.
We want the people to know that there's an announcement that we're working on that's going to be coming on probably within the next 24 hours. And if you want to address that, go ahead, unless you want me to go ahead and do it.
Go ahead, brother. You know this a little bit cleaner than I do. Go right ahead.
Okay. Basically, what we're looking at doing is that if you look at the step three form, go to step three forms, you will notice at the top corner is the date of step two appeal. A lot of people are telling us that date, since it's coming from the step two form, they do not want that date to be populated any longer. They wanted to replace it with date they received the step two form in addition to step two filing date. So just want to let you know you're going to see two things in there that you have to probably type in. It will be the date that the step two was received. So keep out an eye on that. You know, it's not an accident, so when you see that is different. Because I understand some of you, what you have to do is go back to step two form to change that date. You no longer won't have to do that, and we're trying to do this within the next 24 hours. So watch out for that. Okay. We have a new, and of course, the same information on step two appeal to arbitration. From step two appeal to arbitration, I'm waiting for you to go to that form. So the same date change will also be there. And Justin, another thing I want to mention, obviously, it will also change on the grievance summary. Because all this information are transferred to Grievance Summary page, So keep out for that. And we have over almost 277 users. We have a new team of our e-appeal committee. And what we're going to be doing, you're going to be seeing the name of the team. We're trying to have people in your area that are heavy users. And most of these committee members will be people that are already using EGS for the longest time. Who is the best person to tell us how to improve this other than the people that are currently using it? So I'm looking forward to working with Jesus Gonzalez from Michigan and several local presidents and designees that are coming on board. We have our first meeting next week. And the first thing we're going to be doing is all those suggestions that you've been thinking about that you submitted. You say, what did they do with my suggestion? You know, don't lose heart. We're going to go through every single suggestion. We're going to talk to Justin and his group, and we're going to see what we're able to do to move forward to improve the system for you. So with that being said, if there's any question for me that you guys have, you can go ahead and ask the question now or type it in. Otherwise, we're going to round up. Again, I'm waiting for Brother Tony, but he's away right now.
Again, I think one of the questions was that how would management get involved with the electronic grievance system? Will they have access to the grievance system?
The first thing I want you to know as a new user, don't ever, ever use email notification to try to send something to management. And Justin, if you get a chance, maybe we can go through that email notification. Email notification is for internal use only.
Okay. Yeah, that's a good, yeah. That's a good point.
And I think most of the people, what they were doing, what they were using email notification, management were not getting it. All you have to do to send to management is get an email address from them, let them know I'm going to send my step one or my step two or step three, you know, through email. Once you have the email, then go to email moving paper. It's just that simple. So they do not use email notification. With that said, Justin, we can go over the email notification function. And the
The good point, Balogun. The email notification, guys, is like he said, internal use only. And there are two ways to send email within the system. But really what you need to concern yourself with when sending documents at all, when sending any type of documents or moving papers, the only button you need to mess with is email moving papers, all right? Email notification is just internal use when like a step one's being handed on to a step two designee, something like that. Then you could go into the email notification feature within each of the tabs. Or you could even send yourself a notification with an email notification just to let yourself know that, hey, I put this grievance in, or I put the step three appeal form in, and I'm sending myself a notification that I did that. So you can do that, but this isn't where you'll attach documents, even though you can, but this is not where you'll send your moving papers. This is internal users only, so don't try to send anything there to anybody but you or your other users. To send it outside of the system, moving papers is going to be your best friend there.
Okay. Thank you, Joe.
And also, a quick note there, Brother Balogun, we've got some issues with the audio that people are having. So I do apologize for that, but for those of you that are having issues with audio, we did record this session today, so hopefully we will have that recording up within the next few days, so you can come back and some of the audio should be clear at that point. At least we hope so.
And it's probably Justin's accent and my accent. Sometimes he creates audio problems.
Yeah, you're exactly right. I was going to leave that line up to you, brother.
There you go. The other question that came up was a gentleman that was talking to me about not being able to pass information to another steward. And I talked to Justin about this, and I also talked to the local. I believe I was in Florida when that question came up. And the issue has to do with we have stewards that only do step one, and they have to pass on information to the higher, like a maintenance director. What Justin and I came up with, or which I even suggested to them on the spot, is you have to make your maintenance director, clock route director, motor vehicle director, if they have to review your case, at least a minimum office administrator, which they have the right to review, you know, something that comes on. Short of doing another shop steward reviewing your steward information. Because what I'm concerned about is if I'm a maintenance employee and I have access to another steward grievance, I'm just concerned somebody can go in and change what I've done. I have a problem with that. You know, but if you are the higher officer, that is office administrator. So we're going to work through that to see the best way. Otherwise, the best thing to do right now is to give a higher level to those who are reviewing. Justin, are you in agreement with that?
I am, yeah. That's exactly right. So really the issue there would be just to give the particular user a different profile setting like office administrator,
right.
And that would allow that user to go in and edit the case at that point. Yeah,
we just don't want to. Otherwise, why have an administrator, office administrator, when a steward can mess up with another steward grievance? So I don't think it can change from steward to steward.
Right. Okay, gotcha.
Okay, the contact list. I want you to be careful with your contact list. Some people are sending me email that I don't care about receiving. I'm glad I'm on your contact list, but don't send all your email to all your contact list. People are just blasting. You're supposed to send it specifically. Say you're a 202 employee, and you have a contact list of people that you want to send to, meaning the maybe maintenance director, or maybe the MDO, whoever you meet at step one, your local president, and yourself. You can call that 201 group to include all those. But they don't just have a master list and use that to send to everybody.
Right, yeah. I'm glad you brought that up, Balogun. There has been a couple of times where someone has mistakenly sent out multiple grievances to the whole master list within their local union. And this master list could be hundreds of emails in some cases. So be careful. If you see something called master list on your local union, you know, and we've had to go into some locals and just simply the local union administrators ask us to delete the master list because it happened a couple of times. So don't send anything to the master list. The master list is there. It's just a backup list. What you want to do is send it to specific, just like Balogun said, specific people that only need the case. Because that, yeah, that can certainly... it can flood people's inboxes with grievances that are with correspondence that they really don't need at all, you know.
And I just received a notification that all of you can see that the gentleman, Carlos, said, ha-ha, thank you, Mr. Balogun, that was the answer. I was sending things through notification, not to email. Now, I'm telling you, this I always tell my wife, since she's not here, I can tell you guys. The computer is always as good as the user. You know, so the more you learn to use this, the better the computer gets.
There you go. Well, that's good. That means we help the brother out. That works out good, brother. I appreciate it. That's great.
Okay.
All right.
Let me just talk about something that you guys have not mentioned, and since Tony's not here yet, but it looks like we're going to have to just wrap up without him. As far as the paying for the system, I'm sure that's the big elephant in the room. All of you have been asking when. Well, the